Hello, everybody. Welcome back to the Feel Free Again podcast. Today, I am joined by another friend of mine. I'm starting this podcast with a lot of friends of mine and people I really respect. And we're going to have guests, too, who I've never met before, and that'll be fun. I'm really excited right now that these first several guests are people I just highly respect and love and care about. So today we're joined by the wonderful, the one and only Catherine Best. She is another kind of hero of mine, someone that inspires me with the work she's done all throughout her life. And then specifically over the last several years, many, many years, we'll get into that here in a second, but what she's done with the grief recovery method and what she has done with the grief recovery method specifically at helping children and parents of children and schools and school administrators and teachers and, you know, anyone that is dealing on a daily basis with kids. It's been her passion to help empower them and educate them so that they can effectively help the kids in their care. So without any further ado, Catherine Best, I want to welcome you to the Feel Free Again podcast. How are you?
I am great, Cole. Thank you. Am I your first English guest on the podcast? Am I kind of striking up the lead here?
You are absolutely the first British guest. I have my tea here. I'm like all set up. I would love to hear your version of an American accent at some point. That's one of my favorite things to do is have British people talk like Americans. So maybe we'll have time for that. Maybe we won't, but just, you know, don't want to put you on the spot. But again, nothing brings me more joy than hearing British people talk like they're American. So we'll figure that out later. But again, I'm so glad you're here. And really, I want to kind of give you the floor. But I would love to hear a little bit before I do that. I'd love to hear your background on how you got into, again, just, I want to hear your background professionally working with children, what that looks like, when you kind of bridged the gap and found the method, when you started integrating it, all that stuff. But if we could, let's start first at, when did you first kind of get into the work with children?
So my background started off in education. When I left school, I didn't believe I was clever enough to be a teacher, so I went down a different route, which in the UK used to be called a nursery nurse. And you could be a nursery nurse, you could be a nanny, or you could work in schools and support children. So that was kind of the way I went. So I started working in schools as a nursery nurse for years, and then I decided that I could do it, and I did want to pursue a different career. So I then kind of looked at different route options. I then trained to be a primary school teacher, which is from kind of 4 to 12 years. And at that point, I also took a role at a college. So alongside my role teaching children age kind of in that kind of 4 to 12 bracket, I was also teaching at our local college, young people, 16 to 18, courses like early years, kind of your kindergarten style courses, people who wanted to be teachers, people who wanted to work in schools, and everything to do with education and youth work. And so I did those things in parallel for a number of years, then moved from the college up to university. And I was then teaching people on routes into teacher training and youth work and kind of early years kindergarten workers, but at degree level. And as I entered that world, and every day I had, and I'm not going to say just young people, because some of the people in my classroom at university was, you know, the rule was 18 to 80. So they weren't all just young people coming straight fresh from college. They were people who maybe worked in the industry, who'd done this role themselves for many years. And the thing that I felt was always the gap was the emotional development and the emotional support of the children and young people that my students were working with. And we did our best to teach the kind of background of behavior and emotions, but there was nothing practical.
Okay, great. And I would love to get a little bit more clarification on that. So the gap between the students you're teaching and you're teaching them to one day go on and work with children, And in that, you're identifying the gap that they have in terms of interacting with the children and their care on that yeah. daily basis. Is that right?
That's right. Yeah. So, and potentially yep. some of these people, the type of degree they were doing, they were working as well as doing their degree. So they'd be working in a school or in a youth work setting or in a children's hospital, yep. maybe 4 days a week. And then they would come to us at university 1 day a week to get the knowledge side, to take them to that next level, to give them that better qualification so they could get a better job or maybe a higher grade of job. And all the time, we're teaching the very practical stuff, but I'm hearing and know from personal experience, there's nothing in there about what to do if, what to say if, what to say to a child who comes to you and says, my grandma's really sick, or my dad's leaving at the weekend, or, you know, and I don't mind admitting, for many years as a teacher, my focus was on getting those children to attain. You know, my grandma's sick, I'm really sorry to hear that, but you know what, you've got some maths to do here, and it's nearly recess, nearly playtime, and we need to kind of, so can we? And I realized when I came to wow. teach this mm-hmm. that actually we needed to be far better at this, because I was never going to get those children to achieve and attain and potentially even attend if we didn't find a way of dealing with whatever the emotional side was, so that we could then clear the path for the learning and all the other stuff.
Right. So that's fascinating, right? So what I'm hearing you say is essentially, yeah, we want them to raise to these intellectual achievements. And of course, education is about helping them increase their brain power and their knowledge and their wisdom and all that good stuff. But we're actually getting in the way of achieving that goal by basically pretending like they're not emotional beings much of the school day. Right. And yeah. we're focusing so much on the intellect, and we're not empowering teachers to help navigate the emotional, which is, we know, and me specifically and you as parents, we know that they are navigating most of their day emotionally. And then we're over here like, no, but you need to learn intellectually too. And again, that is important, but by nature, you know, children are very emotional in nature, and they're navigating all those kind of things. And if you're a teacher with them, you quite possibly have more time in their day than their parents do. You know, it's not like they're turning off their emotional nature for those 8 hours that they're with you. And you're already identifying this kind of gap in the educational system with teachers. So anyway, please continue. But I love this so far.
So I think the thing you just touched on there is as well about the fact that children, certainly in the place of education, actually spend more of their waking hours with their teacher than they do their parents. Because yep. those children who go to school, the biggest part of their day, there's only a small part left for homework, some fun time, a meal, you know, and it's bedtime. So actually that person who has them for the day has them more of their waking hours than anybody else, whatever their role. And I think the other problem is that very often I certainly felt like, okay, so if I don't know what to say, I'm not going to say anything. Because I'm scared that I'm going to open this can of worms that I'm not be able to close, and we've still only got 10 minutes. And so there's that element as well of, because I don't have the tools, I'm not going to even try, because my focus is on getting these children to tick the boxes and achieve everything they need to. And I think that was one of the key turning points for me, certainly later on, when I kind of then discovered this work. So kind of moving backwards a little, I'm then in a point where I am teaching all these wonderful adults to take all these amazing roles with children and young people. And I then experienced a series of significant losses in a very short period of time. I was on my honeymoon. I had recently remarried. We had gone on honeymoon. My husband and I had taken this amazing trip. It was 2 weeks on a ship. No phone, no internet, nothing to distract. It was amazing. But in that two-week period, one of my very best friends, who was ill when I left on the trip, who was potentially showing signs of getting better the day before I left, died suddenly the day after I left. Leaving behind a husband and two amazing boys. My a family member, her partner was killed in a road traffic accident. And so although they'd recently separated, there was still that connection of a relationship that was still there. And they also had two very small children. And then there was a young man who I taught in reception at the age of five, who I discovered had taken his own life at the age of 22, all in that 2 week period. Mm. And I came back to that and I was full of the joys of honeymoon and amazing times. And all of a sudden it was like, no, I have to be somebody different. And I don't mind admitting I really struggled. I didn't attend funerals for two of those people because I wasn't in the country. So that I found that really difficult to cope with, because to me, that's a part of your chance to say goodbye and talk to friends and kind of come together. I'd miss that. I was back for the funeral of the young man, and it was just lovely to be there, but it broke my heart being in a room full of, I would say over half the young people were there were people I'd taught who'd now grown up. And we're all stood there breaking their hearts at losing one of their best friends. And I sat there thinking, do you know what? I still don't have the tools. I've known for the last few years that this is a gap, and I still don't know what to say or do. And so at that point, that was my charging point. That was the point where I thought, I have to find something. There was very little for the families left behind. There's very little support. There are some great telephone services. There are some great kind of organizations who will talk to people. But what I wanted was something concrete from the people on the inside, either for the family members themselves or for those who potentially spent most of the waking day with those children or young people. And so that drove me.
Well, I love it. And, you know, and we've all been in that position, right? If we don't have a lot of tools and information and knowledge around the topic of grief, we are so terrified to say anything. So maybe it's better that we avoid that person at the market or in the parking lot, right? Or maybe we shift the conversation very quickly with the student in our class who's reaching out to us to communicate something emotionally. But it's like, we don't know what to say. We don't know how to intervene. We may make things worse if we say the wrong thing. We may have an angry parent, wanting a conference with us if we don't know what to do or how to handle it. So I would imagine, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, Catherine, but I'd imagine that the vast majority of well-intentioned teachers out there don't go there, because they don't know what to say and they don't know how to interact. And there was nothing in their training to do that. So anyway, I know I'm kind of reiterating where you are, but so we're at this point, you've kind of hit this crux of your career, of really already being aware of this gap, but now because of your own loss and tragedies, it's kind of at this really boiling point in terms of you're looking for something else. So please continue.
My background then tells me I need to research. So I did the kind of educational thing. I did the head thing. I started to look at research and papers and organizations. And everywhere I looked, never quite was what I wanted. It was all very academic. And I knew that stuff. I don't need to learn about the academic elements of brain development and emotions. I taught that stuff. What I was looking for was something really, really practical and useful. Something that I could use every time I needed it, and that others could too. And my dream at that point was, if I could find something, this could be something that could be built into that teacher training degree, that youth work degree, that police, in this country now, if you want to be a police officer, you go to university. There's learning to be done. If I could find something to build into that, then potentially all these people would have that toolkit, if you like, that they could use. So kind of fast forward, I'm still looking and searching, and a period of time later, I was at an education show, big national event, hundreds and hundreds of stands, And I was walking through this event. I'd taken my students for the day, so it was their benefit. I was just kind of, you know, trying to be in charge and keep them all together and make sure everybody got on the bus home, that kind of thing, even though they were all adults. And I walked past this stand, and I just remember looking, and there was just a sign that said, "Would you like to help children deal with loss?" And that was it. I thought, that's it. That's what I've been looking for. And so I spoke to the person on the stand who was, you know, a member of the Grief Recovery Institute. And they said to me, this is a program we have for children and young people. It's not just for small people. It's for all children of all ages. And it's to give the people who care for them, either their parents or their relatives or somebody who cares for them in a more custodial role, like a teacher or a youth worker or a sports coach, it's to give them the tools of what to say and, more importantly, what not to say when that child is having a tough time. And again, they said to me, this is not just bereavement. This is divorce. This is falling out with friends at school. This is changing schools, moving house. And that was another moment for me. Oh, my goodness me. This is so much bigger than bereavement. This is everything else. This ticks the box amazingly. It's not just about death. It can be used for every single thing that I know a young person has to deal with. And so,
it sounds like it was tailor-made for what you were looking for. Before we go on, please remember where you're going to go next. But I just, for the audience, I want to just touch on just a core concept of ours, which is, and we teach this in our certification program, we teach this in our personal work programs, we teach it across the board. But essentially, when we come into this world, right, and I'm going to get through this pretty quick, but when we get through this world, we kind of have these three parts. We kind of have the spirit, the soul, we have the intellect, and then we have the emotion, right? And as a baby and a toddler, all of these things are firing, right? And we're working and operating from all of these places. And through grade school, I think you call it primary school here in the States, we call it elementary school. But you can watch, if you watch a kindergartner on the playground, and then you go and watch, you know, second graders on the playground, you can see this being cut out of them. And what is being cut out of them is their access and availability to expressing emotions, and their access to the spirit, to the intuition, whatever you want to call it. They are also being told to kind of distrust that. I could give you a bunch of examples, but we don't have time. What is school all geared to do? To help them enhance their intellect. Again, I'm not saying that's a bad thing, but we're beating out of them these other beautiful products of their little beings, right? You know, what you were talking about, Catherine, is when you initially researched topics on this, what you found is a bunch of intellectual things around grief. My dad, I love it. He has this one story where he went one time because he was in the grief world, and he goes, hey, these people are going to, you know, they're going to do a talk on grief. And they go in there, and it's all these kind of big brain PhDs, and all they want to debate is the definition of grief versus the definition of bereavement, right? They want to get into the, like, the nitty gritty weeds of these things. But what they had no tools with were practical tools that would actually help grievers. So in other words, they had way too much intellect, but no emotional capacity, or I should say emotional tools, at how to actually effectively help grieving people. And he said after 10 minutes of this kind of ego-driven, intellectual prowess showing off nonsense, he just walked out of the room. He's like, I got no time for this. And what you'll find is what Catherine has found is when you research the topic of grief, I actually have a YouTube video of this coming out shortly. When you research this topic, you'll find no shortage of people that are stuck here that are really making this stuff complex and very intellectual, which is irrelevant both to our children and us as adults too, when it comes to dealing with an emotional event, which is grief. Grief does not take place here. That's why I don't even love the term mental health when it comes to grief, because grief is in the body. Grief is emotional in nature. And if you miss that, then you miss everything. So anyway, please continue, Catherine. I just wanted to clarify that a little bit.
No, I agree. And that's kind of what I said before, you know, in my classroom, I was like, no, we need to finish this work and everything will be okay. And you just need to carry on. It was all intellect. There was no element.
It's all, hey, let me help you move from here to here, because I don't know what to do. So let's just get you back up here. We've been up here for seven, you know, every time I catch you down here, let's get you up here. And again, this isn't to beat up teachers. We love teachers. I love teachers. It's just about equipping you and empowering you with more tools so you can meet the child where they're at, because that's incredibly frustrating and confusing to a child who goes, I love this teacher, you know, and I feel safe with this teacher. And so I'm going to tell this teacher what's going on with me emotionally. Whoa. Why is the teacher trying to shift me off of that? Why are we having to navigate back to here? And again, I'm not saying that we can constantly be working from here in a daily school. I mean, I know you guys got a curriculum and you got stuff to do. But again, if the default is always moving them up to here, that's what we're teaching them to do. Just alongside the geometry and just alongside the history lessons, we're teaching them, the minute that I go to here and communicate from here, someone that's a big person is trying to get me up to here. They're smart. They know that. Well, right. They think they're training to be adults. So what are they recording in their little hearts? Oh, anytime I express emotion, I better go back to intellect. Right. So anyway, go ahead.
No, I love that. And that's kind of, I will carry on where I was going in a minute, but you made me think then about that realization I had when I learned about the tools and I learned how to use them, that what I very quickly realized is that I could spend even just 30 seconds or a minute dealing with this, which meant that young person then could carry on with their day. So it was win-win, you know, for the child and for the teacher. It's a win. The child gets to express what they need to express, but then because they've been able to do that, they have been able to clear some of that stuff, which then allows them to carry on with the day and focus and do whatever it is else that they're supposed to be doing. So I think that's one of the key fears for teachers and for professionals. Parents not so much, because it's like, well, I've got all day for my child, I will spend as long as this takes to help them get where they need to be. But from a professional perspective, there's that element of how much of my time is this going to take up and how much am I going to have to do. And so, you know, I know we can talk about this later, but that's the key thing. It's about language and communication, and it can be done really quickly and smoothly and just inserted into every conversation. It's not about taking that child away from their activity and finding a special room and having big conversations. It's just about the language you use there and then that helps them shift to here, deal with whatever, and then they can get on with their day. So that's one of the things that, you know, I love about this work. So moving on, the kind of talking at the exhibition about the grief recovery method and the Help a Child with Loss program. And so I realized very quickly, although I had this kind of idea that maybe they could come and teach all my students, it was like, this is not practical. And so the presentation was, well, why don't you train to be a certified grief recovery method specialist, and then you can help all the students you want, all the children you want, you can help other people. And I thought, oh my goodness me, this is it. This will make all the difference. So of course, life always puts obstacles in your way. And at the time, the job I had, it's like, well, you can't take time off. There's no time in school time, and you're only allowed to take leave in certain times. And so I went to the person who knows everything about everything. I went to my dad and I said, Dad, I found this amazing thing. And I love it, and I'm so passionate about it, and I just don't know how to make it work. And he said, okay, let's have a chat. And at the time, I don't mind sharing people, I just got married, we were moving house, and it just wasn't financially a practical time for me to kind of look at something new. And my dad said to me, do you know what? He said, if this is something you're passionate about, let's look about it. He said, I will help you to do the training if I can. So I looked at the dates online and I found that the next training was an hour from me, and it was the first day of my allowed to take annual summer leave. And I thought, this is meant to be. I'm supposed to be doing this. And I'm not really that kind of person that's like, oh, but everything just seemed. So my dad helped me financially so I could undertake the training, and I did what all daughters do and said, Dad, I'll pay you back. I promise you'll get this. And I went and did the four-day training. I went and did the four-day certification training at a location about an hour away from my home. And I just remember it was so overwhelming and exciting and wonderful and amazing, all scooped into one bowl of 4 days. It's definitely, for anybody who's considering it, it's a roller coaster. It's emotional and it's wonderful. And I remember just coming out of those 4 days, and I went home. First people I went to see was my mum and dad, and I said, "Oh, it was absolutely fantastic." And my mum said, "You look like you've been at a spa for 4 days, not on a training." She said, "I was really worried when I spoke to you 2 days ago. You sounded exhausted." I said, "Yep, because that's the beauty of the method. You know, when you come out of the end of this from a personal perspective," because I wasn't a griever. I didn't go and do this because I needed any help myself. I was
none of us are, right?
I was going to help other people. I was going to teach my students. And I remember sitting there and that conversation happening, you know, we're all grievers in this room, and we're like, "I'm not a griever. I don't know what I'm going to do here. I may even have to make something up because I'm not quite sure why I'm here." Boy, did I realize how wrong I was by the time I'd finished a few more hours in that room. And it was absolutely life changing.
Well, and let me ask you this, Catherine, because you've mentioned earlier you're on your honeymoon cruise, right? And you've had all of these losses in the timeline. How many years or months had passed between the honeymoon and you attending that certification, roughly?
Just over a year. So my honeymoon took, about a year, actually. My honeymoon was the summer of 2012, and I trained in the summer of 2013.
Okay, great. So for the audience, let me break something down for you. Okay, so Catherine is headed to a grief recovery certification training, and, you know, we don't put it out there too publicly, but newsflash, I'm going to let you guys in on a little inside secret. When you go through the certification training, we're going to have you do some personal work, because we can't help other people unless we know what it is like to do this work ourselves. So that's a secret, right? It's out of the bag, but I want to stop and mention what Catherine just said, right? She's going to this training. She knows that she's going to do personal work, but she does not think she has any personal work. Well, 10 minutes ago in this conversation, we know she has had many grief events in her life, right? And we just figured out, okay, that was roughly a year ago. This is a very important point that I want to touch on. In my experience, the reason Catherine doesn't think she has any grief to work on is because 1 year passed between all of that loss that we would all agree clearly is grief, okay? But 1 year passed, and therefore Catherine has no grief anymore. Where would she get such an idea, right? I'll tell you where: from society. Because we keep promoting these myths about grief, like time is going to heal it. So, so we wait a year and then we just assume time has healed it. And then what grief work are we going to do? After the training, you were certainly aware of this. And this is why we're so passionate about trying to educate people, is the grief, the unresolved feelings around all those losses and all those people you lost during your honeymoon, that didn't magically all just dissipate and go into the ether because 12 months of time passed, right? There is work we still need to do around our grief. Otherwise, we just keep holding on to it, right? So I'm sure after the training, you understood, right, as most of us do coming out of the training, there is no shortage of grief to work on. And luckily, now we have actual tools to do it. So anyway, please continue. I just want to clarify that for the audience, is all of us out there, most of us are going to say we don't have any grief to work on, right? Most people only think they qualify for grief work if they're like within 6 months of a loss, right? That's the only time they think they can do any work. And then after that, we've either convinced ourselves that we're fine, or we're still hurting, but we're comparing our insides to other people's outsides. So we go underground with our grief. Now we don't even want to admit we're grief. So, there's a lot of misinformation and things that rob us of an opportunity to work on things we definitely need to work on just because of bad information out there. So anyway, please continue, Catherine.
So as I say, I kind of did the 4 days and it was like my world had been turned upside down. I had always been looking for that toolkit, but I had a toolkit and some. And so it was then a case of how am I going to make this work? How do I get this where I need it to be? So from a very practical perspective, I then thought, right, who needs to know about this? Who needs to know about the work with children and young people? And so I decided to put together my first group of participants for the Helping Children with Loss program. And, you know, we're always, I think we, it's lovely in the Institute when we take talking to people about doing this and we say, hey, you know, don't push this for yourself. If it's the first time you're doing it, you know, don't talk to the professionals. Don't get teachers in your group. Don't get social workers. Don't get therapists. You know, get friends that you, people, you know, have children who are going to get something out of this.
And real quick, the reason that we ask and suggest people do that is because if you get too many professionals in a room, they're going to want to intellectualize the work. They're going to want to debate the work. They want to show off all their other tools intellectually, which will be emotionally unhelpful for everyone in the room. Again, this isn't to bash on people with degrees, but we really need people to understand there is a massive difference in how we operate when we're operating emotionally and how we operate when we're operating intellectually. So that's why we recommend don't put a bunch of people in there that are coming from the intellectual operating, because again, it can be done, but it's a lot easier if I'm doing a personal workshop with 10 people that are working from here versus if I have a workshop, and I've had this, where I have like 10 aerospace engineers, okay? They just live here more, they're more comfortable here, so I should be getting paid overtime because moving them from here to here, it can be difficult, right? So anyway, go ahead. So you're on your kind of first group.
I'm getting my list together, and the problem is, the problem is with my list is that everybody I know is a teacher, a youth worker, an educator. So I thought, you know what, I had to put these people, they had to have some of them in the group, and I did, but I made it really clear to them right at the beginning that I wanted them to listen to everything they were listening to from their heart, not their head. The problems we had to solve, that we wanted to solve in the work that we do, are emotional problems, not intellectual problems. And that until we dealt with them emotionally, we were never going to be able to help with all the other stuff that comes with it. And so they sat there and they went through the program and it was wonderful. The problem I had was people kept saying, oh, my friend wants to come. I've told her about this. There's nothing like this. And so very quickly I realized that this wasn't going to be something I was going to be struggling to get people to attend, because actually, because it was different, because it's practical, you know, from an education perspective, every single other course I had ever been on in my life, and I had been on a lot, it was always very, very kind of intellectual, but also there was also lots came with it. So for example, I would go on a training for a day and then I'd spend 3 weeks trying to make resources or trying to find time to do this so that I could implement it in what I was doing every day. What I love about the Helping Children with Loss program, and they all loved, is the fact that this is a toolkit that you keep here, that you carry around with you all day every day, whether it's to have a chance conversation with a child on the playground or a child of your own, or a child that you're sitting at a birthday party with, or whatever the scenario, you don't need resources. You don't need a special room. You don't need anything other than your heart and a conversation, an emotionally honest conversation with that young person. And I think that was, and still is, one of the massively key selling points of this training, if you like, that we are giving people the tools, but there's nothing they have to do to be able to start using it. I know from doing this program, I don't know how many times over the last, well, where are we now? 14 years, 13 years, no, 11, trying to count. 11 years I've been doing this, just over 10 years, 11 years. And the numerous times I've done this every year in those years, the hundreds of people I've taken through this program, that's the fact that they love, that they come to the first session, they learn about the Helping Children with Loss program and the grief recovery method and those thoughts and ideas that are behind it. And like you say, the way society expects us to behave and how that isn't helping and how we have to change that. And almost immediately from the first session, they're coming back to session two saying, oh my goodness me, this week, this is what happened and this is what I was able to say or this is what I was able to do. I already feel like I'm making a difference. I already feel like I'm changing the way I think, the way I speak. And that to me is massive. Absolutely massive.
Yeah. Wow. I love it. You know me, Catherine, we spend a lot of time on calls together. So you've already heard my rants, but one of my major rants about living in 2024 is how much we love to overcomplicate everything. Now, we've overcomplicated mental health and therapy, in my opinion. I'm coaching my kids baseball. We've overcomplicated baseball. Just so you know, Catherine, baseball is a sport we play here in America. We've overcomplicated education. We've overcomplicated just, you know, one person talking to another person and helping them out, right? We need to outsource even that. and that's what I love about our method. Our method will never be overcomplicated. We'll never create $15 words just so we can create $15 words. I like working with people with the emotional vocabulary they have, because that keeps them here, right? Versus my $15 word, which takes them up here, which is not helpful for them, right? And so you hit the nail on the head. This work meets people where they are, which is human beings having a really normal and natural human experience, which is maybe sadness around some events that just happened for them or someone that they just lost, right? In a world that teaches them how to acquire things, but never for a minute really stops and says, here's what you do when you lose something or someone, right? So anyway, you have this new toolbox, you have this new set of tools. I want to keep hearing more from you.
So it was like this amazing kind of, I can't really describe it. You know, in my head, I was like, right, so I've got to get one group together and then I want to gain momentum and I want to keep doing this. And before I'd finished my first group, I had a queue of people saying, hey, we've heard about this course. My friend's doing this course with you. Can I come? So I had my second group. So, yeah. You know, just as an aside there, I'm kind of looking at this thinking, okay, so how can I get this out? And bearing in mind at this point, it's just going crazy. And I'm encouraging as many people as possible to tell as many people as possible. And I live in an area where people don't have a great deal of disposable income. People don't have a lot of money to spend. Most of the people I was coming across were doing this out of their own pocket. So they may work in a school or similar, but the school was going, oh, we've no budget for this. This is not on our radar. We don't need this. But the staff, or the people who were working in those establishments, whether it be football coaching, schools, kindergarten, they realized the need. So they were coming and saying, hey, I'm going to do this myself out of my own pocket. So I've always been really keen to keep it very cost effective, because I would rather have 10 people in that class over and over and over again and charge a smaller amount than kind of run that for 10 people a year. I've always wanted to kind of keep it very cost effective and manageable. But that also meant on the other side that I was able to go back to my dad before Christmas of that year and say, hey, Dad, I'm going to say something I've never said to you before. I'm going to pay you back, which was massive for me. He had had that belief in me that I was going to do this. So I'm like, hey, Dad, this is amazing. And he said, OK, so how can we grow this further? What can you do? So in this process, I had set up a nonprofit so that I could use the skills that I had to help as many people as possible. So that then was my focus very much around the Helping Children with Loss program. And one thing I kind of want to say here as well is within the kind of the teachers and the youth workers, I was also talking to parents and grandparents. It isn't just an educational thing, this.
Yeah.
You know, and I sometimes find that if there's two parents going through a difficult time, it might be an aunt or an uncle or a grandparent that comes and says, you know, I need to help my family. You know, this is what's happening. They're in the middle of it. I want to be able to make a difference. And I think the other thing as well is that the Helping Children with Loss program, the title can be a bit misguiding, because we have to remember that children are of all ages. You know, my youngest child is 32. I use these tools all day, every day when I have communication with all of my children, including my eldest, because the whole point of this program is to give us better communication tools with children and young people. And as a parent, your child will always be your child, no matter how old they are. You know, I've worked with parents whose children are in their 20s, their late 20s. So many young people now, because of the way things have changed over the last few years, maybe had to return home during COVID and never really moved away again. Maybe didn't get the job they wanted after university and have had to go back to the family home. Maybe you've had a relationship breakdown in their 20s or 30s and now financially have had to move back in with parents. And I'm talking to all these parents who are going, oh my goodness me, my child and I, we don't get on like we used to.
Well, and let me stay on that point for a second. So unresolved grief and grief in general can often come from unmet hopes, dreams, and expectations for the future. So I remember when I was growing up, my parents were of a different generation. So when I heard them talk about the good old days, or I heard them talk about how their lives unfolded, right? I was excited. And I just had, as a child, this hope, dream, and expectation that my reality, my adulthood would play out as theirs did. They, you know, and I remembered, you know, we call them the good old days, right? Well, think about our 20-year-olds right now. Think about the millennials. Think about Gen Z, right? Think about the college debt, right? Think about them even attempting ever to afford a home, right? The hopes, dreams, and expectations for the future are being unmet by our youth. They were sold by us, their parents, or, you know, my parents. They were sold a bunch of hopes, dreams, and expectations. Again, this isn't to beat up on parents either. This is just how society plays out. My job, though, is to point out that a lot of our young people are grieving emotionally for the unmet hopes, dreams, and expectations of the future, because they had a different roadmap given to them by well-intentioned, well-loving, meaningful people. This is how it's going to play out. And when our lives don't play out that way, that's a grieving event. Now, are you going to hear this on any other podcast that you listen to this week? No, right? But if you talk to Catherine or you talk to us and you're a young person or you're a parent of a young person, we're going to make sure that this is on your radar, because it's really important for you to know that, you know, again, I'm not singling Catherine's 32-year-old out, but, and I don't know where he's at, but a lot of our young people, again, are trying to navigate this world that is a different world. And it's hard to navigate if we're unfinished with the ideas that we thought were going to be, right? It's hard to get, until we can get emotionally complete with that, it's very hard to leave room for the hopes that these generations do have, you know, the things that can be better for these generations that weren't the best for past generations, right? So anyway, I just want to stay on that for a second. But again, Catherine, please continue.
No, so and it's kind of exactly what you've just said. You know, if you ask any parent whose child is of any age, and I would also, you know, ask yours and my parents this question, who doesn't want to communicate better with their children? It doesn't matter how old they are. And this is what I was hearing all the time. You know, I don't know how to help them. I don't know what to say. I don't know what I can do. All we seem to do right now is argue and fall out because they're having a tough time and I don't have any way of helping them. And so these tools are so universal. And so when people look at the Helping Children with Loss program, I don't want them to look and think, oh, my child's left school now, or, you know, my child isn't small anymore, because your child will always be your child. And sometimes every parent, if they're totally honest, will admit that they need a little help navigating some of this stuff. And to me, if we can give parents better communication tools, and there's nothing in this work that is rocket science, is there, Carl? There's nothing in this that people are going to go, oh, my goodness me, I have never heard that before. What they're going to say is, oh, my goodness me, I never thought about it that way before. I never sat and looked at it like this. And I didn't realize that actually if I do this, then do this, then do this, we both, my child and I, or the child in my care and I, have a much better outcome.
Yep.
And it's
just
so
funny.
Practical and simple.
Yep. And just for a little quick history lesson, right? We developed the grief recovery method for adults. And we had been doing the grief recovery method and perfecting the method for adults for decades before my father and Russell Friedman wrote When Children Grieve. And this program that Catherine's talking about comes out of the book When Children Grieve. Shout out to that book. Definitely pick up a copy if you know a child, period. Full stop. Just go order that book somewhere, Amazon or from us, or it doesn't matter. But the point is in our work with adults and in our interactions with children, we realized pretty quickly children are actually pretty good at dealing with grief. Us big people get in the way of them trying to process their grief. So really, as lovingly as I can say this, really helping children with loss and that program is all about helping us as adults get out of our own way at allowing them to emotionally communicate what they're already trying to emotionally communicate to us, right? And so there's no like mysterious big changeover between the work we do with children and the work we do with adults, okay? None of our work, again, is complex because it doesn't need to be. It shouldn't be. Now, we can help people find all the different feelings that they have around different hurt. We can really help them explore very thoroughly all the different events and the memories. And so I'm not trying to say that this goes very deep, much deeper than most other things, I would argue, but still in a way that is accessible and simple for the person going through it. Would you agree with that, Catherine?
Absolutely. And I think as well, you know, when I think about kind of my vision when I left the training and what I wanted to achieve, it was focused on children, young people, on the Helping Children with Loss program. What I then kind of found from that was these professionals and parents or relatives that were coming through the program were coming and saying things like, oh my goodness me, you know, it's so amazing. From week one, I've changed my language. But then by about week two, some of them were saying, do you know, I think I have some stuff myself. Now, of course, we Yep. know that when we speak to somebody, you know, if a parent is telling you that they're worried about their child because their relationship is broken down and the family home is breaking up and that child is, but their focus is on their child. Their focus is on helping my child, dealing with and giving me some tools to help them. But I love the fact that in the process, they then come to realize very gently that actually they do need help. And the great thing is about our work is that we have the Grief Recovery Method program there for them when they are ready to do that. It's a perfect fit, you know. But I know as a parent, and you're a parent, the ultimate, immediately if your child's hurting, you're going to give to them first. But in all this way, we kind of keep reminding people that there is a program for them too. If they realize that they have things they need to sort out within their life, we can help with that too.
Yeah, I love it. If you come motivated to help your children, who could fault you for that? Great job. You know, well done. Being the mama bear that wants to help or the daddy bear that wants to help. That's great. But absolutely, like, because we'll get this call, and this is a heartbreaking call. You know, I want to help my child, and their father died, right? And in the conversation, we also understand that they are a widow. They were married to the father, right? And mom's so focused on helping the children, who could blame her? And so absolutely, we will help give you the tools to help your children. Your heart is in 1,000 pieces, too, about losing your husband. So the work can't stop with our children. It has to continue with our hearts. Everyone benefits by that model, including your children. In fact, I would almost say if you just purely help your children, but you keep all of that backpack full of grief around the death of your husband, there's a possibility that when those children are adults, we're going to be working on some grief work they're doing on their parent who went from the parent to the griever for the rest of their lives. And that is a sad, sad scenario. And it breaks my heart that I work with people on a regular basis. I work with kids, adult, you know, they were kids when they had a loss of a parent. But they're adults working with me, and they're working on the loss of their other parent who is still there alive physically, but was a shell of their former self for the rest of their life, you know, I mean, it's that dramatic at times, right? And we don't want that for anyone. So the point is, great. If you want to help your child with a loss has occurred, but more times than not, you're also a griever around whatever loss event happened. Not all the time, but very often, right? And so anyway, I'm glad you brought that up, Catherine.
We kind of have that thought, don't we, that if you imagine this program, the Helping Children with Loss program as it is, if you imagine, I always think to myself, if I could replace 7 hours of my life at high school, and I'm going to pick math because I wasn't particularly good and I hated it. And even as a teacher, I used to have to check things before I taught them. You know, definitely 7 hours of some of my later education that I could have easily swapped out for 7 hours of the grief recovery method. If I had had those tools as a young person, if the people who were teaching me in school, my parents were amazing people, don't get me wrong. My mum and dad did a great job. You know, I cannot fault anything they did. But there were things they said along the way that weren't, now I realize, weren't always the best things to say. You know, like first full relationship, you know, when my heart was breaking and I was falling apart, and I went and said, you know, the love of my life, I think I was about 15 at the time, 16, the love of my life has ended our relationship and I'm never going to fall in love again. And my dad kind of said, well, I never liked him anyway. And he did smell a bit funny. And I was like, not what I needed. I needed somebody to go, hey, it'll all, you know, what, don't be sad. Let's talk about what's going on with you. Tell me why. Tell me what's going on. Share your heart with me. And yep. I think to myself, if I had had those tools as a 16-year-old leaving formal education and moving into my adult education, how much different my life and other people's life could be. You know, when we talk to people, not just about the Help a Children with Loss program, but the method, you know, I say to people, just give me 7 hours of your time. 7 hours. To remove some of that weight, those rocks, those stones, those boulders in your backpack, so that you can move forward in life lighter and more joyous and to find more joy in things. And again, with children, if we in all areas of a childhood, parent and professional, can give those tools to young people, because the Helping Children with Loss program is not only about teaching a child how to deal with what's going on with them now, it's also about helping them to get on with next week, next year. So we are not only helping with the situation, but we're giving them an inbuilt toolkit. So the next time, and I kind of like to use the example of a young person, maybe a little bit older, who is having a really bad morning at school. Let's use school, for example, because no matter whether they're your child or they're in education, every child has to go to school or be educated in some way. So you've got this young person who is just at boiling point because something has happened and they're just ready to break a door or throw a chair. And now they're in the bathroom trying to calm down. If they had those inbuilt tools to take themselves through this process, to use the tools they have to see more clearly what's happened that morning, you know, how they can deal with that and be able to give themselves a conversation internally, if you like, to kind of bring mm-hmm. themselves to a different person so they could walk out the door and bring that level down. That's what we want for every child. And I really think that we still have a lot of work to do in helping people understand how powerful that is for the child themselves, not just the people on the outside helping them, but teaching yep. a child that for themselves, a toolkit to deal with whatever's going on in life so that they have a better outcome at the time, not 3 days later or an hour later when they get to talk to somebody.
Yeah, I think we could all probably agree our children need us now more than ever to be the leaders, to educate ourselves, to give them the tools, to empower them. And like you just said, to empower them to be able to know what to do when sad feelings occur, when grief hits, when trauma, when loss happens. They really need us. And We're kind of at the end of our time here, but I want to close with this and then give you the kind of final word. But one thing that struck me in our conversation was all the teachers out there, all the school administrators, all the parents, all the grandparents. Our whole goal is just to share information with you. It's not to critique whatever you're doing, because we know most of the stuff you're doing is amazing. We in this little cross section of information, we want to share with you about how to help kids emotionally when it comes to grief and loss. And when we say grief and loss, you can think pretty much most things that children are dealing with emotionally, right? So don't think it's just about death. It's about moving. It's about changing schools. It's about friends that were once friends that are now mean to them. It's about girls being mean to each other. It's about boys being, you know, it's basically all these emotional events that happen in our childhood. That's what we were talking about, giving you more tools at how to help them navigate those things, right? This stuff will be used every day with you if you interact with children. Every day you will know how to interact differently with my kids. I am so grateful I have these tools. I use them minute by minute with my children. I use them on my 10-year-old baseball team I help coach. I use this on the 11-year-old baseball team that I help coach. Luckily, I got some other great coaches, but the kids all wave to me when I show up at practice, right? And the reason isn't because I'm like this cool special guy. The reason is I know how to communicate with them emotionally. And I know most of the stuff we're dealing with at 9 and 10 and 11-year-old baseball is not critiquing their swing. It's how to help them deal with things emotionally, how to help them manage and work through their emotions when they strike out and they lose the game, or, you know, when they don't get that starting position that they had a hope that they were going to get, right? I know that's what really my job coaching is helping them emotionally at 9 or 10. It's not the technical, intellectual nuances of their swing, right? We're worrying about that later. Okay. But I have a special bond with those kids on that team because I have these tools. That's all. That's the only thing that separates me from the other coaches. All of the coaches are great. I'm friends with them all. They're all well-intentioned. I just have other tools at how to communicate with children on an emotional level. And I'm grateful for that, right? And wouldn't that be cool if we all could have those tools when we interact with our children? Whether you're a teacher, whether you're an administrator, whether you're a grandparent or a mom or a dad, like, these tools will enhance your life and they will benefit your child. The thing that kind of broke my heart that I also loved is the fact that you told me all of these people were paying out of pocket to be here. Like, again, paying out of pocket to have more skills at how to help the children in their care. How admirable is that? The other thing that made me a little bummed out is, and I'm sure if you're a school administrator listening to this, you're probably complaining, but there are budgets, there's money, right? And the fact that, you know, shout out to your dad. I wish I could have met him in person. He just sounds like such a marvelous guy. Shout out to him to help fund this for you at first. Your school should have funded it for you. Your school should have identified immediately. We have someone on our staff that wants to get more skills and fill a gap because we're massively underserving our children emotionally because we don't know what we're doing. And this gal is trying to go get trained in this to bring it back to us. Cut her a check to be here. That's what should have played out. But props to your father for being that person for you, and props to these other people that you had worked with early on that were self-funding themselves to be here because we didn't have it in the budget. Now, if I went line item by line item in school budgets, I would find a bunch of absurdity. I don't care if it's the UK or America or South America. I would find a bunch of absurdity when we need to be training people at how to meet and help and assist children in emotional things they are navigating on a daily basis. Okay. That doesn't mean we're trying to replace parents or, you know, grandparents at all. And sometimes the interaction, like you said, Catherine, may just be a minute of you knowing what to do. And then that child feels heard. Here's a tip for everyone listening. In every interaction in the next couple of weeks with a child in your care, just put in your mind when they're talking, what are they trying to get me to hear? Is this an emotional communication or an intellectual communication? What you'll find is 9 out of 10 times, it's going to be an emotional communication. And depending on kind of who you are naturally, you may not be hearing them communicate emotionally, but if you can make sure they feel heard, things are going to move in a better direction with whatever else you're trying to get with them on for the rest of the day, whether that's math or just them doing chores or them, you know, wherever it is. If you can hear them emotionally, they're not going to have to spend the next 45 minutes doing stuff to try and get your attention that they're trying to communicate to you emotionally. I hope that makes sense. If it doesn't, come talk to us. We'd be happy to talk to you. We'd be happy to share more about what we do, because again, it's all geared towards helping children. So Catherine, let me turn it over to you in closing. Anything you want to cover, and then we'll wrap. But it's just been a pleasure having you here. Oh, let me say this one last thing real quick. So I had heard about Catherine Best, and she was this gal from the UK that got our training. And then she came over to talk at one of our first conferences. Okay. And I remember looking over at my wife, Ashley, and saying, who is this? Because she was going to take this work and she was going to change the world with this work. And she did a presentation on the work she did there in the UK with helping children with loss. And I told Ashley, and I told the team, I said, just let her do whatever she wants with this program, because that's who I've been waiting for, you know, in terms of this program. So I want to just publicly thank you for all the work you've poured in to modifying it, to enhancing it. And I know we're just getting started, but I just wanted to put that out there that I want to thank you honestly, because your heart has been there every step of the way, and what you're doing with that program and where we're going to go with that program is a huge thanks to you. Okay.
Thank you, Cole. And you know that I do really appreciate you giving me that autonomy to be able to make the changes and to keep moving this program forward, and I can't ever thank you enough for that. I think the last thing I'd like to say to people is, don't wait. People say all the time, I don't think I need this now, there's nothing going on right now, you know, or I think my child is okay, or, well, you know, I hear from educators and sports coaches and things like people like that all the time, say, well, we haven't had a death, or we haven't had in such long. It's not. It's so much broader. Like you say, it's about friendship breakups. It's about moving classes. It's about moving home. It's about parents not getting on as well as they used to. It's everything. And why are we waiting? You know, if you want to be a first aider because you want to be there to help somebody when they have a trip or a fall, or, you know, this is emotional first aid. We learning these tools so that we can be there at the moment we're needed. We don't look at somebody who has a fall or breaks a leg that goes, oh, I think I'll get my first aid qualification next week. I think I'll train to help people. We don't. We need it before. And that's so much better. Have the toolkit to be ready. Hopefully, with all the love in my heart, I will say that potentially I always hope that the conversations you are having are not too difficult. But we all know that at some point, that child or a child that we know is going to have a difficult time, and there does need to be somebody there. So I would say, don't wait, and let that person be you. You be the person. And if everybody around you isn't interested in doing it and you are, then go for it. Just like I did. Just go for it and get the tools for yourself. And then when you've done that, you can share it with everybody else. And potentially between us all, we will keep this growing, and we will keep giving more and more people the tools so that potentially every child has somebody to talk to who is actually, like Cole said, hearing them, not just listening, but actually hearing what they're saying to us.
Love it. I am so glad that you found your way to this work. And I want to thank you on behalf of my father and Russell Friedman and all those that came before me. I want to thank you for all the people you have helped that none of us will ever get to meet, right? That's the whole goal of this, is to get this across the world, frankly. And you're a huge part in doing that. So anyway, thank you for watching to all those. If you want to get in contact with Catherine or me, just go to griefrecoverymethod.com. Make sure you get a copy of the book, When Children Grieve. And then I also want to just do a quick shout out to our amazing thousands of certified grief recovery specialists who have this wonderful format that Catherine has talked about. So if you go to our website, there's an area called Our Programs, and down, like third or fourth program down, is going to be helping children with loss. You can click on that. You can find a practitioner in your area that does this work. You can find people that do this program online. But we have the best people who are highly trained, highly professional. And more importantly than all of that, they're not up here. they're down here and they're going to know how to operate with you in a really effective way to pass along these tools and these skills. So I just wanted to shout out to all the specialists out there doing this format, because it is more needed than ever, right? And I think we both agree on that, Catherine. So Catherine, you have a wonderful rest of your evening. It's over here in the morning for me right now, but I appreciate you. I love you. And again, thanks for being on the Feel Free Again podcast. And I can't wait to, I think the next one we're going to do together is when we're both there in the UK in person. We're going to do another episode. And I really look forward to that too, my friend.
Thank you so much, Carl. Love you too.
All right. You take care.
Thank you.